Recorded Books and RB Digital present These Fevered Days, 10 Pivotal Moments in the Making of Emily Dickinson by Martha Ackmann, narrated by the author.
For Joanne Dobson and the Memory of Karen Dandurand, 1946 to 2011, with love and gratitude for where this conversation began. These fevered days, to take them to the forest where waters cool around the mosses crawl, and shade is all that devastates the stillness, seems it sometimes this would be all. Author's note. On the surface, Emily Dickinson lived an ordinary life. She resided in one town, went to school, never held a job, lived in her parents' home, remained single, and died at age 55. To many who knew her, Dickinson's only acclaim was winning second prize for her rye and Indian bread at the annual cattle show. When she died, her death certificate listed her occupation as at home. Dickinson's internal world, however, was extraordinary. She loved passionately, wrote scores of letters, anguished over abandonment, fought with God, found ecstasy in nature, embraced seclusion, was ambivalent toward publication, and created 1,789 poems that she tucked into a dresser drawer. Only after her death, when her sister opened the drawer, did the world begin to realize that the life of Emily Dickinson was far from commonplace. "My business is circumference," she once declared, and the work she produced over a lifetime is dazzling. These Fevered Days takes its cues from Dickinson's own words. "This was a poet. It is that distills amazing sense from ordinary meaning and atter so immense." This book intentionally concentrates, extracts, and distills Dickinson's evolution as a poet. It does not claim to be a comprehensive cradle-to-grave biography. Rather, it seeks to shed light on 10 pivotal moments that changed her. Too often, readers see Dickinson as an artifact in amber, an eccentric spinster who locked herself away from the world. That perspective, while incorrect, is partially understandable. Dickinson did indeed keep herself at a distance in her own lifetime and ours. Biography first convinces us of the fleeing of the biographied, she wrote, as terse a warning to future biographers as there ever was. Yet, while part of Dickinson will always be unknowable, much can be discerned. There are the poems to help us, of course, fragments too. Volumes of letters are also essential, and thousands of archival documents related to her life in Amherst, Massachusetts, her education, her travels to Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, and Cambridge, Massachusetts, her reaction to the Civil War, and memories about her from family and friends. The tangible world surrounding Dickinson is another resource: her home, the paths she walked, the flowers she loved, the light in her bedroom. For America's most enigmatic and mysterious poet, Emily Dickinson left a trail of clues. Readers unfamiliar with Dickinson may benefit from a brief biographical overview that situates these 10 moments. Emily Dickinson was born in Amherst, Massachusetts on December 10, 1830, to Edward and Emily Norcross Dickinson. She had an older brother, Austin, and younger sister, Lavinia. Her father was a lawyer and later a politician. Her mother kept the family home. Emily received superior schooling at Amherst Academy and Mount Holyoke Female Seminary in nearby South Hadley, Massachusetts. She had many friends, and early on, teachers commented on her facility with words. When she returned home after 1 year at Mount Holyoke, she settled in, helping with housework and making social calls. The tedium wore on her. Her first publication appeared in an Amherst College student magazine when she was 21. The prose work, not poetry, was printed anonymously. A few years later, the Springfield, Massachusetts Republican, published her first poem, also anonymously. Emily Dickinson remained single and gradually became reclusive. The family's financial status made it possible for Emily to stay home and not teach, sew for a living, or have other outside employment. By her late 20s, she was seriously writing poetry and gathering her verse into hand-sewn packets, later called fascicles. She shared her love of words with her beloved sister-in-law, Susan, who read her verse and offered advice. When Emily was 31, she took the uncharacteristic step of sending several of her poems to Thomas Wentworth Higginson, a well-known essayist who had published an Atlantic Monthly article offering advice to aspiring writers. Higginson would become Dickinson's literary mentor and one of the most important people in her life. He read her poems with interest, tried unsuccessfully to correct them, and while continuing to write her, eventually gave up offering critiques. After the Civil War broke out, Emily composed poetry with the greatest intensity of her life, sometimes a poem a day. These were compressed verses with striking imagery that focused on her great literary themes of nature, faith, pain, love, and immortality. Toward the end of the war, Dickinson faced a medical crisis. She worried she was losing her eyesight. Emily traveled to Boston on two occasions to be treated by a physician and lived in a Cambridge boarding house. When her personal trouble was finally behind her, she met Higginson face to face. That 1870 meeting was remarkable, and Higginson's vivid memory of it offers the best account ever recorded of what it was like to sit across from Emily Dickinson and hear her talk non-stop. As her reclusiveness intensified, so did the mysteries around her. One riddle concerned Charles Wadsworth, a minister Emily had met on a trip to Philadelphia. The two had written each other, and Wadsworth had visited the homestead. There were also three master letters, drafts or possibly copies of mailed letters, later found among her papers. No one knew who the unidentified master was, or even if he actually existed. As she grew older, one person Emily knew as a child came back into her life, Helen Hunt Jackson. Jackson had become a renowned poet, essayist, and novelist. She also was a friend of Thomas Wentworth Higginson, and he reacquainted the two women with each other and their literary work. In 1876, Helen visited Dickinson and implored Emily to submit her verse for publication. The poet refused. In her final years, Emily Dickinson endured one loss after another, first her father, then friends, then others close to her. She kept writing, but admitted, "The dyings have been too deep for me." Ill health overtook her slowly, and she died on May 15, 1886. She was buried next to her parents in West Cemetery in Amherst. Emily Dickinson had published only a handful of poems during her lifetime, and all anonymously. It was not until after her death, when her sister discovered sheet upon sheet of poems, that the staggering sweep of her literary achievement became known. The first edition of her poems was published posthumously in 1890. Which 10 moments are the subjects of this book? Chapter 1 introduces Emily's family and her budding artistic sensibilities. The chapter focuses on an important announcement she made to a friend, a statement declaring, "All things are ready." Chapter 2 presents an evening at Mount Holyoke Female Seminary, where the school's legendary founder, Mary Lyon, asked Emily if she felt prepared to profess her faith. Chapter 3 traces the chain of events that led to the publication of Dickinson's first poem. Chapter 4 zeroes in on a wintry morning when Dickinson announced she wanted to be distinguished. Chapter 5 details the composition of Dickinson's masterful poem, Safe in Their Alabaster Chambers. Chapter 6 chronicles the day Dickinson took the most startling step of her life and sent 4 poems to Thomas Wentworth Higginson, asking for advice. Chapter 7 depicts Dickinson during the Civil War, under the care of a Boston physician and in the throes of a medical crisis. Chapter 8 portrays the momentous day when the poet met Higginson for the first time. Chapter 9 describes Dickinson's childhood friend Helen Hunt Jackson paying a call and chastising the poet for not publishing. Chapter 10 recounts the day Emily Dickinson died, the subsequent discovery of her poems, and the enduring legacy of her work. The conceit for this book, its focus on 10 pivotal moments, originated in my teaching. For nearly 2 decades, I taught a Tuesday afternoon class on Emily Dickinson in the Dickinson Homestead in Amherst, Massachusetts. My Mount Holyoke College students discussed Dickinson in the very rooms where the poet created her work. Sitting around that seminar table, the students demonstrated that they understood Dickinson's life and work more deeply when our conversation centered on an important moment in the poet's life. When we considered the poet's stance on religion and poems that confronted God, for example, we found it useful to look at a February night in 1848 when Emily Dickinson went head-to-head with the formidable founder of Mount Holyoke Female Seminary. What did Dickinson say about that event in letters? Did that moment affect the rest of her life? Do her poems reflect the choice she made then? There were other days that were similar when the poet was altered, pivoted, and not the same as she was before. Something had transpired in those moments that had moved Emily Dickinson toward the poet she would become. The change might have been prompted by a letter she was writing or had received, an emotion she articulated, a passing thought, a visit, a trauma, a conversation, an event that was supposed to happen but didn't. The moments we studied in class, and others that I have added here, spanned almost the whole of Dickinson's life, from the time she was 14 years old until the day she died. The 10 moments are chronological, but not consecutive. Each chapter revolves around a specific day and a particular change. A day when the poet was different, say, at 10 o'clock at night, from how she was at 10 o'clock that morning. Other Dickinson scholars could surely offer a different set of moments for reasons that are entirely different from my own. Over the years, selecting 10 turning points in Emily Dickinson's life has been a kind of parlor game I have played with colleagues who have long studied Dickinson. My list of 10 is not definitive. No list would be. But after 40 years of teaching and studying the poet, this set of 10 makes the most sense to me. Emily Dickinson did not keep a diary. Sometimes months went by without a word. Large gaps frequently appear in her correspondence. There is not a single letter for 1857. We must also be reminded that the poems and letters that we have today are the ones that have been recovered. Who knows how many manuscripts have been lost? Compounding these challenges is the fact that Dickinson rarely dated her poems. Establishing an accounting of how she spent her time, while not impossible, can be a hard row to hoe. In addition, Emily Dickinson's life was not filled with action, at least not in the conventional sense of the word. The poet moved through her days in ways some people would see as inactive. She tended to her house and family, read, and wrote. But Suzanne Uhas, in her landmark essay, The Landscape of the Spirit, argues that Dickinson did indeed have an active life, a life that was lived in her mind. Uhas believes the poet did not retreat and run away from the world. Rather, she was capitalizing upon a technique that women have always known and used for survival, using the imagination as a space in which to create some life other than their external situation. What Dickinson did, Uhas states, was to make art from it. If we read Dickinson's letters looking for action in the usual sense, where she traveled, what chores she did, whom she encountered. We find some details for reconstructing her days, but not many. But if we read the letters for what the poet thought, her interior world opens. Reading Dickinson's letters in this alternate way was a revolutionary shift for me. This book attempts to crack open that interior world, recreating a landscape of Dickinson's consciousness. While each chapter circles around a specific day, it also spools back through time to past thoughts and events informing that moment. For example, in Chapter 9, Dickinson and Helen Hunt Jackson had difficulty finding a time to visit each other. The poet was grieving her father's death, and Jackson had recently married. Certainly, those two life events had bearing on the day they eventually met, what they said and how they acted. "Forever is composed of nows," Dickinson wrote. "Let months dissolve in further months, and years exhale in years." Each of these 10 chapters, then, is a snapshot of Dickinson's present moment, with the past in dissolve, like a multiple exposure. Several themes emerge when considering all 10 chapters as a whole. First, Dickinson was ambitious. From an early age, she keenly felt the passage of time and wanted to make the most of her days. As a girl, she dedicated herself to a year of improvement. As a young woman, she announced she wanted to be distinguished, and after her first serious poem was published, she thought about fame. While publication was never something Dickinson actively sought, she frequently imagined a future when poetry would bring her renown. Another theme is Dickinson's long view toward her work. Poems never seemed to fade from her mind, and she constantly revised. When she recognized a good phrase, she reused it, altered images for different purposes, and returned to lines sometimes decades later to make the slightest of shifts. I share Karen Dandaran's view that Dickinson did not publish because poetry to her was never finished. She looked upon her verse as constantly in play and the work of a lifetime. Her attitude is reminiscent of Paul Valéry's assessment. A poem is never finished, only abandoned. She was, as her 19th century contemporaries would have said, long-headed. Looking at the span of Dickinson's life, I am also struck by how much the poet knew her own mind, both in terms of her need for solitude and what she hoped to achieve in her work. Dickinson recognized that she required the isolation of quiet days. While she was aware that others occasionally viewed her as strange, she never wavered in seeking solitude and never apologized for it. The poet also knew what she wanted to achieve in her verse. When she sent her sister-in-law safe in their alabaster chambers for critique, she listened to Susan's advice, but went in another direction. She reacted the same way to Higginson's recommendations, open to his criticism, but holding fast to her own point of view. A final theme that runs throughout Dickinson's life is her belief in the sustaining power of art. Early in her life, Emily witnessed how her aunt Lavinia Norcross confronted sorrow by turning to music and art. No doubt the young Dickinson was already inclined in that direction, but Aunt Lavinia's example was profound. It's hardly surprising that Dickinson wrote with such ferocity during the Civil War. High emotion fueled her. She turned to writing poetry in times of joy and love, and especially in hours of anguish. "I must keep gas burning," she wrote, "to light the danger up." Creative expression was the fundamental force of Emily Dickinson's life, and writing poetry both defined and sustained her. In researching these fevered days, I have consulted Dickinson's letters and poems, and also archives at the Jones Library in Amherst, Amherst College, Mount Holyoke College, Harvard University, and many others to consider the importance of the town of Amherst, the role of women's education in the 19th century, boarding houses in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and myriad other details. But because this is a work of narrative nonfiction that seeks to animate Dickinson and bring her story to life, I have also wanted to convey the shape and texture of her world. Since I have lived near Amherst for many years, I am familiar with the play of seasons here, the sheltering mountains that ring our valley, and the sound of the train that ran by her house and now runs by mine. But as familiar as I am with Amherst and Dickinson's home, there were still details I needed to ferret out. And for that, I relied on friends and neighbors. Chapter 8 opens with Emily returning from medical treatment in Boston and climbing to the family's attic to read Shakespeare out loud. She detailed the moment in a letter to her cousin. To gain a better sense of the sound, smell, and feel of that long-ago reading, I asked Dickinson Museum Executive Director Jane Wald if I could go into the homestead attic and have a look. Jane has always been gracious to accommodate my capers and obliged again this time. The attic hasn't changed much since Emily read Henry VI up there. I spent an hour examining the dappled light that filtered across wood-hewn beams and read some Shakespeare to test how sound vibrated across the rafters. I sought other experiences as well to bring sensory verisimilitude to this book. I paced off the distance in a snowstorm between the Dickinson house and her brother's home next door for the opening in Chapter 4. I turned the pages of fragile, yellowed newspapers to examine what Dickinson read every day. When I wanted to know what the night sky looked like on the day Dickinson died, Alfred Venn at Amherst College projected it for me on the curve of the Bassett Planetarium ceiling. Weather is not far from people's minds when they reflect on a particular moment. The day was cloudy, they will remember, or freezing cold, or hot as blazes. For climate specifics, I consulted the pioneering work of Ebenezer Snell, Emily's neighbor, a 19th century Amherst original, and a man utterly obsessed with weather. For over 30 years, Snell kept a meteorological journal, recording Amherst temperature, precipitation, cloud formations, and atmospheric phenomena. I used his large leather-bound journal and the record his daughter continued to keep after his death to begin each chapter. Most memorably, I spent hours writing this book in Dickinson's bedroom, listening to the sound of the footsteps on the stairs, looking out her windows, and feeling the warmth of afternoon sun. I hope these details lend a palpable way to imagine the 10 moments and offer an intimacy and immediacy not found elsewhere. I first discovered Emily Dickinson when I was a 16-year-old student in high school. I remember sitting in my fifth period English class at McClure High School in St. Louis and opening our textbook to Dickinson's monumental poem, After Great Pain, a Formal Feeling Comes. I couldn't untangle a single line. I was lucky. At 16, I had not known great pain. But after reading that verse, second row, fourth seat back, something changed in me. It's taken me years of study and the rest of my life to understand what that was. Looking back, I can now say that after reading the poem, I woke up. A clarity flashed in me that made ideas and writing suddenly visible. It was as though I caught a glimpse of what poet Richard Wilbur calls a wild shining of the pure unknown. If I were writing the 10 moments of my own life, that day in high school would certainly be among them. But what happened in my high school classroom said more about Dickinson than it did about me. Even though I did not have the life experience to explain her great poem, I still, on some level, understood it. Part of Dickinson's genius, it seems to me, is her ability to trigger a reader's understanding. We do not need to explicate every line to sense the import of her words. The weight of Dickinson's language, what she would call its heft, is felt in a place beyond our intellect and sparks a visceral response. Emily Dickinson tells us as much in that famous 1870 visit with Thomas Wentworth Higginson, detailed in Chapter 8, the poet declared, "If I read a book, and it makes my whole body so cold no fire ever can warm me, I know that is poetry. If I feel physically as if the top of my head were taken off, I know that is poetry. These are the only ways I know it. Is there any other way?" Emily Dickinson has been called everything from the outlaw of Amherst, the best friend of reclusive English majors, and an intellectual terrorist. She even called herself the only kangaroo among the beauty. I hope these fevered days offers a rich and vivid sense of her unparalleled life. There is no doubt she is a towering poetic voice. But there's something else about her, too. Emily Dickinson reminds us what it's like to be alive. And when she does, she takes our breath away. March 19th, 2019, Leverett, Massachusetts. Chapter 1, All Things Are Ready. Sunday, August 3rd, 1845. Ebenezer Snell woke early. Looking east to the Pelham Hills, he saw dawn saturate the Connecticut River Valley. He dressed, careful not to disturb his wife and five daughters, and walked outside to check his scientific apparatus. Snell was 44 years old, the first graduate of Amherst College, and now a professor of mathematics and natural philosophy at his beloved college on the hill. Not a large or robust man, he had such a modest manner, some of his first students called him Miss Snell. They loved him for his kindness and delighted, like everyone else in town, in his obsession with weather. For the last 10 years, Professor Snell had risen every morning to record measurements and scientific observations in a large leather-bound journal. Now he opened the book, skimming past the title page, "The Meteorological Journal Kept at Amherst College, Longitude West, 72 degrees, 34 minutes, 30 seconds, Latitude North, 42 degrees, 22 minutes, 21 seconds, station 267 feet above the ocean, commencing 1835. Turning to the new day, he wrote, "Sabbath, August 3rd, 1845. Every year, Snell added new columns and categories to his tabulations: wet bulb measurements, dry bulb measurements, mean temperature. Pure air was a frequent exclamation. For today, though, he concentrated on his six original calculations: barometer, attached temperature, external temperature, clouds, wind, and fall of water. Sunrise, he wrote, and then recorded barometer 30.000, attached thermometer 69 degrees. External thermometer, 57 degrees. Cloudiness 8, southwest, cirrus. Winds southwest 1/2. Fall of water 0. In the margin, he jotted down additional remarks. Vegetation suffers from long drought, plants withering, smoky in the morning. Later that day, Professor Snell would return to his journal and record 3 additional sets of numbers for 8 a.m., 3 p.m., and 6 p.m. He also included one more observation. When he was outdoors at noon and looked up, Snell saw a parhelion, a bright circle ringing the sun. He picked up his pen and added the note. Less than a mile down the road, 14-year-old Emily Dickinson knew what she wanted to do that summer day. Emily loved Sundays. She enjoyed the visits of friends and family who stopped in the afternoon for lemonade or the family's homemade currant wine. In the evening, she joined other Amherst residents in Mr. Woodman's singing school. Everything about music enthralled her. She especially loved long Sunday conversations with her older brother Austin when he was home from boarding school. The two sat by the stove and said whatever entered their minds, that is, until their father opened the kitchen door and the siblings swallowed their words with barely concealed smiles. What Emily did not like about Sundays was going to church. The service was long and the hymns were accompanied by a bass viol and, according to one parishioner, appalling. Emily was lucky. Her parents did not demand that she attend services, and she occasionally slipped out before communion and walked home. Other times, she would endure morning worship in order to earn the privilege, as she put it, of avoiding another service later in the day. More often than not, though, she simply chose not to attend at all, and her parents did not protest. It was not going to church that Emily loved best about Sundays. With the house quiet, she felt unleashed. Not that she did not love her family. Living under the same roof with her mother and her father, brother Austin and younger sister Vinnie, always felt right to her, even as she grew older. But being alone set loose in her a potent force. With no one around, she would proclaim, "I am left alone in all my glory." Today, Emily wanted to stay home and write a letter to her friend to buy a root. Recently, Emily's consciousness had shifted. Sitting down at her desk felt more solemn, more purposeful, and she wanted to make an announcement. Her words would be nothing so bold as a manifesto or even a declaration. They would be quieter, but no less convincing. Emily wanted to tell her friend that she could see her future and was ready for the days before her. She was putting Abaya on notice, perhaps the world as well, that she was serious about writing. Nothing gave her a greater sense of pride or made her feel more alive. Years later, those who marveled at her dazzling words wondered what she could hear that others could not. She answered once, "All have gone to church, the wagons have done passing, and I have come out in the new grass to listen to the anthems." But before she wrote Abaya, Emily had to settle in, her mind switching as it frequently did from her family to her friends, from school to home, and even Sunday meeting. As much as she tried to avoid church, Emily had to admit that sermons at First Church of Amherst had been better since Reverend Aaron Colton had become the minister. Congregationalists in town were hard on their clergy, opinionated, demanding, and tight with money. When one of Colton's predecessors was sent packing, The deposed minister's wife spared few words about the good people of Amherst. New Zealanders would have behaved better, she snarled. Emily liked that Reverend Colton did not fall into the habit of spouting religious platitudes. If she had to sit in church, she preferred it would be Reverend Colton's. At least his language had color and vitality. Emily always paid attention to words, more so than to the spiritual injunctions. When someone's language was stale and predictable, she lost interest and her mind wandered. But when words made ideas come alive, she was transported. Her father could be caught up in language too, even the language of sermons, although most people would have been surprised that Edward Dickinson could be carried away by anything other than a legal brief. After hearing one sermon at Boston's Park Street Church, Edward had written home, "If I could hear such preaching every Sabbath, I would walk 10 miles in mud, knee deep. I do really wish Providence would so order it that we could, now and then, have something worth the trouble of hearing. I could never sleep under such preaching and never tire." There were no reports of Edward sleeping in church that drowsy August morning, although it was growing warmer by the hour. Hot weather bothered Emily, and she knew First Church would be stifling with too many people sitting too closely together. In Friday's newspaper, Professor Snell had reported that Amherst had shattered several records for heat. If Emily needed any additional excuse for missing church that morning, she had one in Reverend Colton's absence. Colton was away from the pulpit, and in his place, two Amherst College professors assumed the preaching duties, Professor Fowler in the morning and Professor Warner in the afternoon. Spiritual guidance by way of professors of rhetoric on a steamy summer day, squeezed into rigid pews next to townsfolks mopping their faces, did not sound inviting to Emily, certainly not as appealing as being alone at her desk. Emily said the summer of her 14th year had been the best of her life, and she wanted to share everything in the letter to her friend Abaya. The two girls had attended Amherst Academy together the year before, along with Emily Fowler and Mary Warner, the rhetoric professor's daughters. Now that Abaya had moved and was living hours away, Emily was eager to pour her thoughts onto the page. She had much to tell. There was a new piano in the house, the family's first, and she was learning lively marches and popular songs. The academy's summer term was nearly over and public examinations were around the corner, the dreaded examinations, she thought. All Emily could think of were those tall, stern trustees staring when teachers called upon her to recite an aspect of biblical law. "I am already gasping," she wrote. But her preoccupations in the letter were not solely about school. She told Abaya about cutting bookmarks, new births in town, gardening, and drawing forget-me-nots. All the girls were making herbariums. "I have an idea that you are knitting edging," she said. Emily also loved sharing gossip, especially accounts of romantic couplings. Who, she wanted to know, was this Mr. Eastcott, the one who gave Abaya concert tickets? "I think for my part it looks rather suspicious." She noted Abby was taking interest in William. "Don't you think he will make a devoted husband?" she wrote. Sabre was going back to Baltimore in a few weeks after honoring us poor country folks with her presence, she added. "And poor Hattie doesn't seem to have time for anything now that she was teaching school. I have some patience with these school marms," Emily all but sighed. "They have so many trials." As she wrote, Emily examined the pen stand on her desk. She knew the letter was going to be a long one and could take a while to compose. So many words and ideas crowded her mind, they seemed to rush ahead of her hand. "I can hardly have patience to write," she once told Abaya. "I have worlds of things to tell you, and my pen is not swift enough to answer my purpose at all." Lately, Emily had made a ritual of writing a letter, clearing space and time, and even her small desk in order to gather her thoughts. She studied the surface before her as if moving the inkwell would help her concentrate or anticipate the words ahead. She now took a slow, deliberate, formal, even ceremonious approach that prepared her for writing, and she expected Abaya to be ready as well. She imagined her friend leaving behind every chore and sitting down with her letter. Placing words on the page and envisioning Abaya savoring her sentences carried weight for her. Emily said a voice inside her head commanded her to write. She called it her faithful monitor, and she could not keep it quiet for long. Nor did she want to. If anyone that Sunday suggested that there was an element of the sacred to her ritual, she likely would have disagreed. There was no open Bible, no sanctified cloth, no preacher or even professor substituting for a divinely inspired voice, not even a candlestick before her. This ceremony was liturgy of a different order. If her desk were indeed an altar, it was a shrine not to God, but to words. That summer, the Dickinson family was enjoying hard-won stability. Gone were the days when Edward and Emily Norcross Dickinson and their three children had to share half a house with Edward's parents. As cramped as the living arrangement was, it was worse when Samuel and Lucretia Dickinson were forced to move to Ohio for financial reasons. Dickinson's grandfather had been a pillar in the community, a lawyer, politician, and one of Amherst College's first trustees. A diligent man with lofty dreams and good intentions, he often rose before dawn and walked 7 miles to court in Northampton because he was too impatient to wait for the daily coach. Samuel's impulsiveness extended to financial matters as well. He had been reckless with his own money, and other people's too, and gave far more to get Amherst College up and running than his personal finances could afford. When he withdrew to Ohio for a job as head of manual labor at Lane Theological Seminary, his spirits were broken, and few thought he could recover. He did not regain his health and died of lung fever in 1838 at age 62. "Ever since I can remember," Edward's sister observed, "our father's life has been one of anxiety and care and disappointment." Samuel's death affected the young Dickinson family in a number of ways. For Edward, it meant a lifetime of working to reclaim the family's prominence and reestablish his father's good name. For Emily and the rest of the Dickinsons, it meant living with the specter of Samuel's failure and sharing the house again, this time with a family unrelated to them. General David Mack and his wife Mary took up residence in the western half of the old homestead, while the Dickinsons moved all their furnishings to the east. General Mack, the owner of the hat factory in town, was an imposing figure to Emily and her siblings. As a boy, Austin remembered the first time he saw the general. "I thought I had seen God," he said. "Tall, erect, of powerful build, a believer in law and penalty." Austin called him a Puritan of the Puritans. Living alongside General Mack and his family in tight quarters lasted 6 years. Then the Dickinsons knew it was time to strike out on their own. By 1840, Edward had earned enough money in his law practice to buy a house on West Street, around the corner from the homestead. The two-story frame home had a grape arbor, lattices, and with 2 acres, enough ground for flowers, a vegetable garden, a horse, and chickens. The chickens were Austin's pride. He once boasted in a letter to the local newspaper asking if anyone's hens laid larger eggs than his. The flock had a habit of wandering off the property, and good-natured neighbors frequently could be seen carrying the Dickinson's feisty prize rooster back to the coop. When 16-year-old Austin was 25 miles away studying at Williston Academy, Emily kept him up to date with chatty letters of neighbors' foibles and barnyard drama. "The other day," she began, "Francis brought your rooster home, and the other two went to fighting him while I was gone to school. Mother happened to look out of the window, and she saw him laying on the ground. He was most dead. But she and Aunt Elizabeth went right out and took him up and put him in a coop, and he is nearly well now. While he is shut up, the other roosters will come around and insult him in every possible way by crowing right in his ears, and they will jump up on the coop and crow there as if they wanted to show that he was completely in their power and they could treat him as they chose. Aunt Elizabeth said she wished their throats would split." Letters to Austin were not the same, of course, as having him sit with her by the stove, but they did provide a way for Emily to stay close to her brother. "There was always such a hurrah wherever you was," she wrote. The new home suited Emily's mother. Home meant everything to Emily Norcross Dickinson, and she delighted in finally having a place of her own to raise a family. The house was still near enough the town center that she could stroll to First Church to help with the summer ladies' fair, or drop into Cutler's General Store for oranges, imported French chocolate, or all those coconuts the family loved. Proximity also made it easy to be involved with town events. When the local temperance society met at the Amherst Hotel, for example, Mrs. Dickinson joined the crowd in congratulating the proprietors on banishing rum. Yet no one around Amherst would ever call Mrs. Dickinson genial or a natural when it came to socializing. She had a reserved quality that kept others at a distance and her innermost thoughts to herself. Since Amherst was a lively and learned town, it was difficult for her to duck away from conversation after lectures at the college or during political events when officials frequently tapped her husband for a public role. One professor's wife, Deborah Fisk, put her finger on 2 qualities that made Amherst unique. Amherst, Massachusetts, she said, was filled with a very spending evening sort of folks, and its best women were free from silly, birdish airs. Emily Norcross Dickinson, while a serious woman, did not easily fit the expectations when it came to spending evenings. Some residents mistook her diffidence for gloom and went so far as to call her doleful. One acquaintance complained that a call on Mrs. Dickinson was full of her usual plaintive talk. There were other criticisms, too, even from family. Everyone grumbled that she did not write enough letters. Her mother-in-law became so exasperated she once declared sarcastically to Edward, "Tell Emily I wish she would write her name in your next letter, so as not to forget to write. I would write her sometimes if she would answer my letters." Harsh as such appraisals were, the rebuke did not cause Mrs. Dickinson to change her ways. Even though Sunday was a day when many people caught up on letter writing, she did what she enjoyed most: baked cakes, tended to her exotic figs, darned socks that Austin had sent home for mending, and, according to her elder daughter, surveyed her domain. Writing to her brother, Emily once joked, "Mother taking a tour of the second story, as she is wont, Sabbath evening." Although some Amherst residents would quibble that a house abutting the town cemetery, charming residence though it was not an ideal location. The Dickinsons felt they had space and privacy at last. But hours alone were not easy to come by for young Emily. The Dickinsons always seemed to have people around. In the early years of their marriage, Emily's parents had taken in boarders to earn additional money and provide protection, as Edward argued, for his wife when he was in Boston on business. Edward's forthright sister-in-law, Lavinia Norcross, did not see the situation that way. All those boarders made for more women's work, she said, and her sister did not need to be kept so incessantly busy with cooking, cleaning, and maintaining a household. With more money in the bank now, the boarders were long gone, but the house still was full. Either Aunt Elizabeth was staying for a few weeks, demanding that young Emily look under the bed for who knows what every time she went to sleep, or family friends sent their children to live with the Dickinsons while the youngsters attended the academy. Vinny or Emily had to double up on those occasions and share their beds when guests were with them for extended stays. As long as Emily was allowed a retreat from time to time, she did not mind the company. Strain for Emily, however, came from the demands associated with her father's many obligations. Now that he served as Amherst College treasurer, students trooped in and out of the house with tuition payments. Professors stopped by with advice on how he might eke out more money from the State House. And trustees sat in the parlor urging Edward to use his growing political clout to the college's advantage. Edward's responsibilities were not limited to his law practice and college duties either. He was president of the Henry Clay Club, the local lyceum, and the Franklin and Hamden Agricultural Society. As an elected official, he served in the state senate and became a representative to the general court and the governor's council. Edward liked the tumble of politics and was good at it, but being away from Amherst and his family for long stretches grew wearisome. He vowed to stay put and never run for political office again, but then he waffled and won another election that took him back to Boston for months at a time. Nothing curbed his continued civic involvement, not even a furious constituent writing in the local newspaper. Was there ever, standing on two legs, the critic wrote, such a lump of hypocrisy, deceit, trickery, craftiness, corruption, fraud, and cheating as is filled up in this 6-foot sprig of Whiggism? A few years earlier, when enterprising young New Englanders looked west and began purchasing land, Edward had uncharacteristically jumped in. He bought acreage in Michigan on the Lake Huron side. For a moment, it looked like the allure of someplace else might take the Dickinsons away from their deep roots in Massachusetts. But recently, he'd made up his mind, and this time he did not waver. He sold off the Michigan property. Father's life is a boisterous one, Emily observed, and like her mother, she accepted family duties and the commotion at home. Sometimes, though, she wished she could be as light-hearted as her sister Lavinia. Vinny genuinely enjoyed company and could carry on conversations and laugh with ease. Emily would make appearances when she had to, but wearing a public face at her father's events drained her of energy she preferred to expend elsewhere. To say Emily and her 11-year-old younger sister shared little in common would be a mistake. Although Vinny usually dove into female chores with an enthusiasm Emily could not understand, I don't see much of Vinny, she once remarked. She's mostly dusting stairs. The sisters shared much, including a similar sense of humor. Young as they were, they both had a cultivated sense of the absurd and loved scanning the newspaper, Vinny sewing and Emily reading aloud, searching for articles they found comical. Their favorites were stories of improbable calamities and shocking deaths, articles that Emily described as funny accidents where railroads meet each other unexpectedly and gentlemen in factories get their heads cut off quite informally. What made the stories so funny, she said, was that reporters told them in a sprightly way. Take the article 2 days ago in Friday's newspaper. A fine cow belonging to Mr. William Feeder of Mannheim died a few days since from some intestinal ailing, having taken her food and drink with difficulty for several months past. Resolved, if possible, to ascertain the nature of the disease, Mr. Feeder had a post-mortem examination of the animal, where a live milk snake nearly 3 feet long was found in her stomach. The italics would have amused Vinny, never mind the snake. Like all Dickinsons, Vinny also was protective, fierce, and loyal to a fault. Although she may not have known why Emily needed privacy and so much time alone, she gave her sister both. Not being overly concerned about reasons and consequences may have been exactly the attributes Emily found indispensable in her sister. After they had grown, Emily looked back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.